Please stand. The entrance hymn is Song of Good News, number 276, on page 90.
Let us begin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the grace and peace of our risen Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
In today's gospel, we will hear about two disciples walking to the town of Emmaus when our resurrected Lord comes to them and walks with them. Knowing that our Lord is with us now, for he has risen, and walks with us today, let us take one moment as we begin this Mass of Thanksgiving to be mindful of our failings and to place our trust and confidence in God's mercy and forgiveness. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts, in my words, in what I have done, in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my fault, through my most gracious fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, Ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to life everlasting.
Amen.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God in the highest, and on earth, peace on earth, peace to people of good will. We praise you, we praise you.
Let us pray. May your people exult forever, O God, in renewed youthfulness of spirit, so that, rejoicing now in the restored glory of our adoption, we may look forward in confident hope to the rejoicing of the day of resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and proclaimed, "You who are Jews, indeed all of you staying in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to my words. You who are Israelites, hear these words. Jesus the Nazarene was a man commanded to you by God with mighty deeds, wonders, and signs, which God worked through him in your midst, as you yourselves know. This man, delivered up by the set plan and foreknowledge of God, you killed, using lawless men to crucify him. But God raised him up, releasing him from the throes of death, because it was impossible for him to be held by it. For David says of him, 'I saw the Lord ever before me, with him at my right hand I shall not be disturbed. Therefore my heart has been glad, and my tongue has exulted. My flesh too will dwell in hope, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor you will suffer your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. My brothers, one can confidently say to you about the patriarch David that he died and was buried, and his tomb is in our midst to this day. But since he was a prophet and knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants upon his throne, he foresaw and spoke of the resurrection of the Christ, that neither was he abandoned to the netherworld, nor did his flesh see corruption. God raised this Jesus, of this we are all witnesses, exalted at the right hand of God. He received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father and poured him forth, as you see and hear." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, you will show us the path of life.
Lord, you will show us the path of life.
Keep me, O God, for in you I take refuge. I say to the Lord, "My Lord are you." O Lord, my allotted portion and my cup, you it is who hold fast my lot.
Lord, you will show us the path of life.
I bless the Lord who counsels me. Even in the night my heart exhorts me. I set the Lord ever before me. With him at my right hand, I shall not be disturbed.
Lord, you will show us the path of life.
Therefore, my heart is glad and my soul rejoices. My body too abides in confidence, because you will not abandon my soul to the netherworld, nor will you suffer your faithful one to undergo corruption.
Lord, you will show us the path of life.
You will show me the path to life, abounding joy in your presence, the delights at your right hand forever.
Lord, you will show us the path of life.
reading from the first letter of St. Peter. Beloved, if you invoke as Father him who judges impartially according to each one's works, conduct yourselves with reverence during the time of your sojourning, realizing that you were ransomed from your futile conduct, handed on by your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a spotless, unblemished lamb. He was known before the foundation of the world, but revealed in the final time for you, who through him believe in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are in God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please rise. Open the scriptures to us. Make our hearts burn while you speak to us.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you.
That very day, the first day of the week, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem, called Emmaus. And they were conversing about all the things that had occurred. And it happened that while they were conversing and debating, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing as you walk along?" They stopped, looking downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, said to him in reply, "Are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know of the things that have taken place there in these days?" And he replied to them, "What sort of things?" They said to him, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people. How our chief priests and rulers both handed him over to a sentence of death and crucified him. But we were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel. And besides all this, it is now the third day since this took place. Some women from our group, however, have astounded us. They were at the tomb early in the morning and did not find his body. They came back and reported that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who announced that he was alive. Then some of those with us went to the tomb and found things just as the women had described, but him they did not see." And Jesus said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, how slow of heart to believe all the prophets spoke. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, Jesus interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. As they approached the village to which they were going, he gave the impression that he was going on farther. But they urged him, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening and the day is almost over." So Jesus went in to stay with them. And it happened that, while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. But Jesus vanished from their sight. Then they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures to us?" So they set out at once and returned to Jerusalem, where they found gathered together the 11 and those with them who were saying, "The Lord has truly been raised and has appeared to Simon." Then the two recounted what had taken place on the way and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Today's gospel is, of course, one of the resurrection stories that we hear during the season of Easter, but one that is quite different from the other stories that take place around the tomb or in the locked room where our Lord appears. This is a story of two disciples on the way to another town. And in their encounter with Jesus, there's a spiritual movement that underlies what takes place, the similar spiritual movement that often is found in our own lives today. And so the gospel at the beginning says, two of Jesus' disciples were going to a village 7 miles from Jerusalem called Emmaus. Two disciples. It tells us a little later, one is named Cleopas, whom I do not believe is referred to by name anywhere else in Scripture. The other disciple is unnamed. These are not apostles, but they are disciples of our Lord. He had many. During his life, he sent 72 out at one time to partake in his ministry. And so these are just two common disciples. Not one of the apostles, not a well-known disciple like Mary Magdalene or Martha or her sister Mary, but rather two who are disciples of our Lord with him, but relatively unknown in the Gospels. And they were walking to Emmaus there on that Sunday morning. They were carrying on with their lives. Much had happened. Jesus, whom they were followers of, had been crucified on the Friday before he died. But now they continue to live, and they were moving on, carrying on with their lives, walking from Jerusalem to Emmaus. And then in the gospel it tells us, Jesus himself drew near and walked with them. Jesus takes the initiative. He's the one who draws near to them. And he does not do so in a spectacular way. This is not a resurrection story where the apostles are in a locked room and Jesus appears in their midst. Rather, in a very ordinary fashion, Jesus appears on the road and draws near to them. He does not force himself on the disciples, nor does he get them to change their plans. Jesus accompanies them with what they were doing, walking the road to Emmaus. And so he joins them in what they are doing. He joins them as a stranger, someone unexpected, someone not recognized by his own disciples. And so they start discussing, the disciples, to this stranger, their Lord, saying the things that took place in Jerusalem, and they said this: "We were hoping that he would be the one to redeem Israel." We were hoping. Past tense. They were downcast, as the gospel tells us. They felt dejected. And then some of the women had reported that the tomb was empty and they saw a vision of angels. So they were unsure and they were confused. But even so, they spoke openly about what had happened. And so Jesus, it tells us, interpreted to them what referred to him in all the scriptures. Jesus once again takes the initiative. And he reinterprets from scripture his own story. What happened to our Lord himself, his passion and his death, and of course, his resurrection. And he reinterprets the very experience those disciples themselves had in Jerusalem during that week when our Lord was arrested and tried and crucified and buried. They experienced that, and he now reinterprets that experience through the scriptures, starting with Moses and going through all the prophets. And then the gospel story tells us that Jesus stayed with them that night at their urging. And so it happened that while he was with them at table, he took bread, said the blessing, broke it, and gave it to them. With that, their eyes were opened, and they recognized Jesus for who he was. Through the breaking of the bread, the stranger was finally revealed to his disciples as their Lord. Jesus had been walking with them on the road. He had been talking with them. He had been enlightening them through scripture. And they did not recognize or understand who he was. But then in that moment, when they finally realized it was our Lord through the breaking of the bread, they could now look back and understand that, yes, it was the Lord who was with them all this time. They could say, were our hearts not burning within us as when he spoke to us on the way and opened the scriptures? Now they could feel the presence of Jesus, not just in the present moment, but in the past as he was with them. As it often is for many of us, that we often have to go through an experience fully, and only looking back come to appreciate the presence of God being with us, God's grace strengthening us and encouraging us, that we don't always feel and appreciate in the moment, but only afterwards, when we get a sense of enlightenment and peace, we're able to feel that presence of our Lord having been with us along the way. And so what did the disciples do now that they recognized that it was the Lord Jesus? They set out at once and returned to Jerusalem to see the other disciples, no longer downcast or dejected, no longer unsure or confused. Their destination had changed. They were leaving Jerusalem, going to Emmaus. But now they had changed and gone straight back to Jerusalem. Their destination, their lives, had now changed from their encounter with the risen Lord. All because Jesus was with them on the way. This story of Emmaus is also our story here today. We do not walk alone. We could be that unnamed disciple, each one of us, that is in the story with Cleopas, to whom our Lord draws near. The Lord walks with us in the life we lead, even in moments where we may feel downcast, where we may feel unsure, where we may feel confused. Jesus takes the initiative. He draws near to us, and he walks the same road that we walk, with us and at our side. Not a different road, but the road that each one of us finds us on. Through his word, he strengthens us and guides us. Through his body and his blood and the breaking of the bread, he satisfies our hungers and our longings here in this world. Our part as disciples of the Lord is to be open to encountering him, even in unexpected ways. And when we do, when we realize that yes, Lord has been with us, his grace and presence have been with us, then our eyes are lifted and we can perceive and see clearly how he has always been with us, walking our lives with us. Confident in our Lord's presence with us here and now, let us profess that which we believe. I believe
in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father, through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in the glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The wisdom of the scriptures reveals God's plan for us. As we journey with Christ, let us pray that his path of life may become clearer each day.
For the pastors of the Catholic Church, that they may continue to nourish us with God's word from the scriptures, let us pray to the Lord. For the nations of our world, that the good news of Christ the risen Lord may bring social justice to all, let us pray to the Lord. For those suffering in the darkness of error and despair, that the scriptures may be explained to them as light and truth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord of glory, hear our
prayer. For those of us present here today, that each one of us may recognize the real presence of the risen Lord in our breaking of the bread, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord of glory, hear our prayers.
For all our faithful faithful departed, that they may rise to the fullness of joy in God's presence. Let us pray to the Lord.
Heavenly Father, our hearts burn within us as we listen to your only begotten Son. Accept these prayers we offer you through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Pray, sisters and brothers, that this our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name and for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Receive, O Lord, we pray, these offerings of your exultant church. And as you have given her cause for such great gladness, grant also that the gifts we bring may bear fruit in perpetual happiness. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but in this time, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. He never ceases to offer himself for us, but defends us and ever pleads our cause before you. He is the sacrificial victim who dies no more, the lamb once slain who lives forever. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise, and even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Indeed, holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come, until you come, until you come.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Stephen our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into light of your presence. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
United in faith, let us pray together the prayer that Jesus himself has taught us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant us peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
May the peace of the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer to one another a sign of peace.
Peace be with you.
Lamb of God,
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body of Christ keep us safe for life everlasting.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Please rise.
Let us pray. Look with kindness upon your people, O Lord, and grant, we pray, that those you are pleased to renew by eternal mysteries may attain in their flesh the incorruptible glory of the resurrection through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
And may the blessings of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you, remain with you forever.
Amen.
Our celebration has ended. Let us go in peace.
Thanks be to God.